Adrian was exhausted, too. He had been racing around the Banner Good Samaritan Hospital campus, handing out blue and pink candy cigars. After, he had roamed an additional 2 miles to the innovative new Phoenix Children's Hospital, which smelled fresh, new, and not at all like the antiseptic smell of illness the older hospitals had. It didn't matter to him that the cigars he held were both pink and blue. Adrian had bought boxes for both possibilities of gender, as he had not wanted to know the sex in advance. When he distributed the pink ones, he just yelled, "It's a boy, sorry." It also didn't matter to him that he was doing this at Phoenix Children's Hospital, which mostly served children who were currently sick. He was beside himself with joy. If there was any pushback from parents, worried about their own children and not wishing to celebrate with him, he'd just say the sorry part. Adrian was non-athletic. Not in the best shape for someone in his 20s, so running around in the heat at 3:30 p.m. made him feel sick, too. Contrary to the myth of high noon, Phoenix was its hottest between 3 and 4 p.m. Also, as humidity crept in during the summer, the dry heat was another myth busted. Before they moved there, he used to tell Millie, "It gets so hot in Phoenix that you can fry an egg on the sidewalk." That also wasn't true. He'd tried that as a kid, and it hadn't worked. He researched, and according to a cookbook owned by one of his foster mothers, the frying pan needed to be heated to 158 degrees, and the sidewalks in Arizona never reached that. Adrian's lungs burned, and his sweat drenched his shirt. He had to constantly push the bridge of his glasses against his nose, or they might slide off and break. He'd been to the optometrist for an adjustment. But after a few hours, his glasses would slip down again, so he kept making more appointments to have them tightened again. Logically, an optometrist should be able to find a solution for this problem. Adrian was just about finished. He had just run the equivalent of a 5K around the areas neighboring the two hospitals. He was worn out and decided to walk, instead of run, back to Banner Good Samaritan Hospital. He was still breathing hard, his head bowed, glasses barely hanging on his face, while clutching 2 cigars in each hand, 2 blue and 2 pink. On Thomas Road, a young couple nearby noticed his distressed state. From the outside, they looked like typical Arizonians, but as they walked closer to Adrian, they appeared to have been up all night and all of the morning partying. She had a limp, but her winged back blonde hair was cemented and unmoved by her gait. She wore enough makeup to cover 3 people, and her orange t-shirt had the sleeves cut off, producing an open vent that allowed Adrian to inhale some of the sour smell which wafted from under her arms. "Are you okay?" the woman asked, pulling on a sleeve of the extra-large, well-worn Phoenix Suns t-shirt. Adrian huffed out a quick yes as his glasses fell to the ground. The woman bent down and retrieved them for him. It was from this perspective she noticed the cigars in his hand. "Congratulations! Did you have quadruplets?" Adrian was lightheaded and mentally fatigued. It had taken a lot out of him extending himself to strangers at the hospitals. Now that he had stopped his expedition, he longed for people he knew to surround him and Millie in their hospital room at Banner. He was tired of speaking to strangers. He was hoping this interaction would be quick and easy. "Yes," he breathed.
"Oh, that's wonderful," the woman said. "A boy and a girl! Can we have a cigar? How about a blue one for me and a pink one for Bobby there?"
Bobby looked like he needed something to get his saliva up and running. Adrian hoped the guy wouldn't collapse
Or even worse, that he would have to resuscitate him if he collapsed because Adrian felt like collapsing himself.
Yes, Adrian repeated.
He handed her the pink one. No, no, Bobby's over there.
Yes.
Give me the blue one.
Yes.
Are you sure you're okay?
Yes.
You're not looking too well.
Yes.
The air was so hot that Adrian's words squeaked out of him.
You sure you're okay?
She asked.
Because the good Sam is right over there,
using the hospital's common nickname.
Yes.
Okay, then. Congratulations, and thanks for the cigars. Again, he said yes, as if they were the only words possible. Within 10 minutes of getting back to the new assigned room, Adrian was asleep in the beige hospital lounge chair. Millie, also sleeping, was breathing gently, wearing a slight smile. Millie's teeth were slightly crooked, but not crooked enough to have required braces as a teenager. Her dark hair remained stringy from the delivery. The sweat had visibly dried to salt on her forehead. It made her look older, although she was often seen as 10 years older than she was maturity-wise, but also given her body was soft in places women's bodies become right around that time. Baby Joe was curled on the mattress, his head against the space where Millie's arm met the sheet. He was not asleep. He was quiet, comfortably wrapped in the hospital's white blanket adorned with pink and aqua-colored stripes. When the nurses checked in, both Adrian and Millie were still sleeping. So they took infant Joe to run their own unofficial tests on him. It was then that Joe felt heaviness in his diaphragm. His shallow breaths quickened. The nurse quickly spoke to Joe in a hushed tone.
No, honey, it's all right. It's all right, she said in a way tiny Joe misunderstood, in context, feeling he was doing something wrong.
Joe calmed quickly in the nurse's arms. What they didn't know, as there was no way they could have, that this was the first time Joe attempted to both please people and attempting to disappear from the world. What they did know was a growing concern, causing various emergency meetings about a baby born that wouldn't cry.